it's I think we're going there. Now, you've written many books, but what inspired you to write this one?
Colin, I rarely think I only write books and quite a lot of stories, which you will not have yet read along. But to write anything is when I think I've seen something that nobody else has quite seen in the way I've seen it. And so it could be, or something really quite original. I mean, sometimes you delude yourself and think you're the only person who's actually got this point. And I think that I did really want to, I think my life was such, this is not an autobiographical novel, but I've certainly, I've always been uncomfortable with the notion of the fall. It's a fall from innocence, that's all. That's the only fall in the fall. And the idea of the act of love being something which is sort of contrary to the creative intention is, to my sense, destructive of the presumption that the good Lord, as it were, knew what he was doing. I mean, they are deeply integrated. And I think at some point in this book I say something like that the solvent of faith is love through the experience of wonder. And that comes between, you know, very much, most vividly and most obviously, I think, in most people's life in the time of falling in love, or between man and woman particularly, I mean, which is, you know, the familiar experience. Even at one remove, or but very often for each one of us, you know, and a very rare thing, and a very amazing thing, and a rather wondrous thing, and something closely to do with the reproduction of the species, which is also part of the creative idea. So that I think that triggered me, and I felt that nobody's really rehearsed this quite enough, although people do return to Profane and Sacred Love. My earlier book, Pandemonium, that I mentioned earlier, was on that theme. This goes much more wholly into it. And in doing this, I then incorporated into this story the sanctity of all things out of the reduction of my main protagonist and narrator to a nothingness. And out of that, what overwhelms him first is the sanctity of nature. When he's in the final bit, when he's in the forest, and the sense that, you know, the trees are carrying the God's banner, and the rediscovery of that vision he had as a boy, that this was personal to me, actually, in that high place in the Massif des Morts in southern France, therefore all of nature was incorporated, all of art in the sense of the music particularly related to his wife, and the need to give honor to the threnody for the child that she'd written for their lost child. And the powerful, physical, joyful, but more, much more than physical, the enormous presence, with his other love, which sustains through the book, predates his marriage, and then somehow comes back into him with Evie. And so all of those things are compounded together, really, on the last page, almost the penultimate instance. And therefore, I want to say that this is love at work, self-loss at work, love interpreted as self-loss at work, in every area of human experience, of things, of nature, of beauty, of art, of each other, and each other physically, too. So that's what's kick me off.
That is, it's a very religious book in the sense that here we have a priest who's a believer who is lost in a forest. Is he spiritually lost as well?
Well, I think he's spiritually incoherent, which is very easy to get, I think. That perhaps be kinder to him. He feels himself lost. I mean, rather as Dante felt himself lost, I think. And then Dante then developed, and he was a scholar, and I was in the Massif des Morts actually at the time of the great crash of 08 in a house party. I've changed the house party, but I know the Massif des Morts. I know every bit of territory that I'm running about, funnily enough.
Is the church real?
And the church is also real. It actually is there. Saint Sauveur, I think it's called, and it still has a roof. And I described that precisely. Let's see, where were we?
Was he spiritually lost?
I think incoherent. He felt himself kind of deeply inadequate at the house party, which he recalls, which that was that very earlier day lunch, when they looked to him, and people, the way people do, you know, sort of people who are three-quarters secular, but sort of faintly abasant to the idea of the good old C of E or whatever they were brought up with. And when he could have sort of really pulled them round and said, this is the way things are, when they got talking about it. When the main guest was on the edge of end of life, and he knew he couldn't do it, and that was sort of a great sense of insufficiency, because he was actually, I mean, he was complicit with the sort of sheer sybarism of the life that was going on there, and he had retired from his ministry, also out of a feeling of the kind of irrelevance of so much of his life as a Suffragan bishop in the place I invent, like Tewkesbury, what it was, I think I invented, had come back to academia, which was again a sort of retreat from the actual grist of his faith, and then he re-rehearsed what brought him to that faith, and he was, I suppose, a modern Christian in our terms, who is absolutely not to cavil over what is metaphor and what is straight historicity and what is myth or hearsay. If it works and brings, we're dealing with parable, as our Lord did. I mean, he told everything in parable, virtually everything in parable.
So is your book a parable or is it a metaphor? Yeah. Because there's a line in your book that says the vast unspeakable secret of our Christian church has been spoken. It taught metaphor.
Yes, I think the book is indeed a metaphor. I mean, and it has to be.